The views expressed on the following program do not necessarily reflect the views of Money Radio staff, management, or advertisers, and do not represent an offer to buy or sell any securities. Some interviews heard on this program may be sponsored by the participants. It's time for Health Futures with Cypress Home Care Solutions, Bob Roth. This is Arizona's only show dedicated to providing you with expert advice on how to live a longer, healthier, and happier life. To learn more, call 602-264-8009. That's 602-264-8009. Now, here's your host, Bob Roth.
Good afternoon. You're listening to Health Futures, Taking Stock in You. I'm your host, Bob Roth, and it must be Friday. And indeed it is. It is the first Friday of April. Happy Friday to all our listeners out there. If this is the first time you're tuning in, our show is called Health Futures because our show is about how our older adult population can live a healthier, happier life. And how do we do this? We do this by bringing extraordinary guests here to the show. It's hard to believe that it is already zoomed into April. We coming at you live from the Scottsdale Money Radio Studios right here in the Air Park, 105.3 FM, 1510 AM, and the World Wide Web at moneyradio1510.com. The last 2 weeks, we've covered COVID-19. They've kind of been like special report episodes, and this episode is going to cover COVID-19, but it really got preempted from the events that were happening in March, and it is a really important topic. It's a topic that we talk about usually in the month of March because March is the month of recognizing that it's colorectal cancer awareness, and I am happy to have on the show. I think this is your third time on, Dan?
Yes, it is, Bob. Yeah,
third time on the show, and I always have you on in March, and unfortunately, we pushed it into April, but it's still close enough to March, and it's such an important topic. I want to talk a little bit about colon cancer awareness month and some of the stuff that you're seeing out there. So real quickly, Dan is a Harvard-trained
gastroenterologist.
Gastroenterologist, there you go. I know Susie's listening in, and she's probably laughing. Now, so you've been practicing for almost 30 years.
That's right. I'm turning 60 in approximately 7 days.
It's so funny that, you know,
which means now that I'm high risk for COVID, because right now I'm 59, but once I turn 60, my risk goes up.
There you go. But you know what's interesting? Guys don't mind talking about our ages. I mean, if women I have on the air, they're just like, I am older or I am in this range, but you look great, by the way.
Thank you.
Hard to believe.
You look great, too.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So let's jump into
this. Good thing this is radio. No one can see us.
That's right. This is must-see radio. But I have a face for radio. But real quickly, colorectal cancer awareness is one of those silent killers out there, and it's one of the most preventable cancers. And we've talked about this the other two episodes that we've had, two times we've had you here on the show. All you really need to do is get screened. So I want to learn more about what are you seeing. It's been a year since I had you on the show. How have things changed?
Well, recently, of course, things have changed dramatically because of COVID. But in terms of colorectal cancer, it is still the number two cancer killer in this country. It is also one of the most, if not the most, preventable cancers we have if detected early or even prevented. And there's very few cancers that are preventable. You can wear sunscreen, stay out of the sun, visit your dermatologist, your primary care doctor, take a look at your skin. It's not going to prevent you from getting skin cancer, but you want to treat it early. Women, of course, know about mammograms. Mammograms, unfortunately, do not prevent breast cancer. They detect it, but screening is important. Colonoscopy is one of the things that we can do as a lead time screening exam that will actually prevent future colon cancer.
Wow. And you're doing this, you know, and interesting enough is that I've always learned that you're supposed to wait till you're 50 years old to start getting screened. And if you get a good screening, you get a 10-year pass. If you get a marginally one with not too much complications, you get a 5-year, which I'm proud to say I got a 5. I didn't get a 10. My wife Susie got a 10, but you're recommending now to get screened, or not so much you are, but the experts are recommending to get screened earlier now, right?
Yeah, approximately 3 years ago, we started noticing an uptick in colorectal cancer and rectal cancer. And by the way, there's sometimes some confusion. Is it colon? Is it large intestine? Is it rectum? When we refer to colorectal, we're talking about the entire large intestine through and including the rectum. We started to notice an increasing uptick of patients developing polyps and cancer at younger and younger ages. So in February, 2 years ago, the American Cancer Society, the American College of Gastroenterology, recommended a change in the guidelines to age 45. So 45 is the new 50. Everyone and anyone is now eligible to be screened at age 45 for colorectal cancer.
And also for minorities. Some need to be screened earlier, right?
We did know previously that African Americans get colon cancer earlier. So it has always been recommended that African Americans be screened at 45. Now, this is for people of average risk. Anyone that has a family history of a first degree or primary relative with colon cancer or colon polyps should be screened even earlier than 45. Typically, what we do is we calculate that if, for example, you had a precancerous polyp at age 50 on your screening, that your children would be advised to have their first screening colonoscopy at age 40, 10 years prior to your first detection. It's kind of scary, Bob, because you and I, our children are the same age. My daughter is born in 1991, my son is born in 1993, and I was born in 1960. My daughter and son's risk of developing rectal cancer is 4 times higher than my risk at age 60, and
wow,
2 times higher for colon cancer. But most young people don't think to have colorectal screening at their age. I'll give you an example. Just 2 weeks ago, before Governor Ducey had the declaration that we were no longer doing elective procedures, I saw a lovely mother of two, age 37, still breastfeeding. She had had some gastrointestinal issues, very mild, very subtle, a little gas, a little bloating, little cramps. And I asked her about bleeding. And she said, well, I've noticed a streak of blood every once in a while, but I'm sure I have hemorrhoids after having two children. So we discussed the potential risks. She didn't have any family history, but she knew that something just wasn't right, and she came to see me, a gastroenterologist, for some treatment. And I had informed her of this information, and although it is rare, I have diagnosed patients with colon cancer and colon polyps in their 20s and 30s. So I had suggested that perhaps we perform the exam to rule out ulcerative colitis or Crohn's disease or polyps or other potential treatable diseases. And she agreed to the colonoscopy, and turned out that she had a very large polyp in her rectum, which I was able to remove completely. Fortunately, it was benign, and it had a few streaks of blood. So it was very fortunate that she came to see me and that she agreed to do the procedure, because at age 40, she would potentially be facing rectal cancer, possibly radiation, chemotherapy, or worse yet, a colostomy bag. So listen to your body. If you notice changes, and certainly if you notice blood, you should get screened.
Well, it's interesting. You talk about listening to your body. I mean, your body's an incredible machine, and it does talk to you. And, you know, fortunately for her, she got to you early enough, because as you shared with me, even before we even got on the air, had she waited, the outcome could have been completely different than it really was. You know, it's hard to believe we're down one segment. We're going to get ready to start a second one really shortly here. And, you know, one of the things I want to do is I want to pick up on COVID-19. We can't not talk about it, because it is consuming us in the news. And, you know, the one thing I want to talk about is I learned recently that they are finding this virus in people's feces. So I want to talk more about that, Dan. You've been listening to Health Futures, Taking Stock in You. I've got Dr. Dan Meline here in the studio. He is a GI doc. Stick around. We're going to talk about COVID-19 when we come back.
Now back to Health Futures. Futures, taking stock in you. If you have questions about your own or your loved one's future health care, call 602-264-8009. Now, here's your host, Cypress Home Care Solutions, Bob Roth.
Welcome back. You're listening to Health Futures, Taking Stock in You. I'm your host, Bob Roth. And if you're just tuning in, we're in our second segment, and I've got Dr. Dan Meline here. He is a GI doc. He is the medical director of also Scottsdale Endoscopy Center, and he's the founding member of Arizona Digestive Health with offices valley-wide. So if you missed our first segment, we actually talked about it being Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month last month, and Dr. Dan was telling us that, you know, you need to get screened not at 50, but 45. And certainly those that have family history, certainly sooner. And he did share a story with us with a young pregnant woman who had a rather large polyp. And, you know, one of the things that you did say, Dan, was you listened to your body and she listened to her body. She was in to see you and averted something that could have been a real disaster. So I want to jump in and kind of pick up where we left off in the first segment, and that is I just recently learned that this virus that we are hearing about, COVID-19, which is consuming all of us, and I want to make sure our audience realizes that, you know, Channel 12 News is really talking about facts over fear, and there is a lot of fear out there, but we certainly need to understand the facts. And one of the facts is that we are to shelter in place or stay at home here in the state of Arizona. And please heed our governor's request. We need to blunt the curve. We need to make sure that we put a lot less strain on the healthcare system. And Dan's going to talk to us a little bit about that and what his practice is doing in that regard. But Dan, I want to really talk to you about this virus showing up in feces. Is it going to go into the plumbing? Am I going to sit on a toilet and I'm going to get this virus because somebody else sat on it? I mean, these are the things. I prefaced it facts over fear. So talk to me about what's going on.
Great question.
He's laughing, but that's okay.
I've known Bob a long time, and he tends to lean a little towards the hypochondriacal side of life. But let me state some facts. Key symptoms of COVID-19 include, of course, cough and fever. But a number of patients can also have or exhibit GI symptoms as well, including diarrhea. Now, this does not mean that if you're home having hot wings and have some diarrhea that you should go rushing off to be tested. But the virus has been isolated from feces and stool. When Governor Ducey shut down Scottsdale Endoscopy Center 2 weeks ago today for elective procedures, I don't think he was quite aware that he was also protecting the gastroenterology community and staff from possible transmission. Risk of infection of transmission is mostly in the immediate vicinity of COVID-19 patients, mostly generated by cough and aerosolized particles. That's the 6 feet keep your distance.
By the way, we are 6 feet apart. I just want to go on record. You can't see this. This isn't live TV, but we're keeping our distance, and our whole studio has been sanitized. And I got this hand sanitizer right here.
Which is a hot commodity, by the way.
I know. My wife, they better still be here when we leave, okay, Dan?
My wife, Lisa, is home making her homemade hand sanitizer for all of her friends. And Bobby does take this very seriously. He does have a tape measure, and he is making sure that we're maintaining her six feet of distance. And it is a ghost town around here, by the way. It's me, Bob, and one tech in this entire giant building.
It's crazy.
It feels apocalyptic to just not see people.
And before you jump into this, someone took a picture and shared with me the Las Vegas Strip. That looked apocalyptic. Yeah. That was incredible. There wasn't a soul on the Strip.
Empty. So all endoscopic procedures should be considered aerosol-generating procedures, because sometimes patients, they cough or retch during an endoscopy procedure or colonoscopy procedure, and theoretically the virus could be passed in flatus. Now, before you get all excited and worried, we're already supposed to be washing our hands after using the bathroom, and we're very well familiar with fecal-oral spread of innumerable diseases like Helicobacter pylori,
It's like easy for you to say.
Salmonella, Shigella, Campylobacter, Clostridioides difficile, or C. diff colitis. So many, many GI pathogens are passed by fecal-oral. It doesn't mean that we're eating feces. It means that we're inadvertently contaminating utensils and foods and things that we touch in the kitchen that we might ingest these particles. We completely do not know at this time if COVID can be transmitted fecal-oral. It's a theoretical discussion, but droplet transmission is first and foremost. We're still not even sure about contamination from surfaces, although we're all being quite diligent about wiping down our surfaces as well.
And we also are learning about aerosol too. I mean, we're learning that, you know, that aerosol, the 6 feet that we're keeping distance, coughing and sneezing, I mean, that can stay in the environment for a number of seconds, so that, you know, it can also go more than 6 feet. It can go up to 28 feet, they were saying, something like that. So
apparently you've seen me sneeze before.
I have. And did you see me back up?
It goes far. That's why it's important when people are out hiking, biking, walking, to really maintain your distance, because somebody walking 5 feet in front of you could have sneezed or coughed, and even though you're keeping your distance, there's the possibility you could walk right through it a few seconds or minutes later. The real reason why we were closed down for non-elective procedures, quite simply, was to conserve our, now everyone knows about, personal protection equipment, PPEs.
I know. No one knew what it was before. Now we all know what it is.
We use gowns and gloves and masks and IV fluids and all sorts of things that need to be channeled to our hospitals and our emergency rooms right now. So one of the reasons why we have been, why we have temporarily closed is to conserve precious resources where they're needed the most. However, I do want to point out that Scottsdale Endoscopy Center is able to open for urgent or emergent procedures.
That's good to know. It really is.
And the reason for this is not out of any sort of monetary need or greed. In fact, for us to open up our center and staff it to perform a procedure is quite costly, and we're better off not to open from a financial point of view. However, what we're doing is we're considering ourselves frontline to help decompress the burden on our hospital systems and our emergency rooms. So some examples of what might be considered a gastrointestinal emergency. If you are having difficulty swallowing, choking on your food, or concerned that food is not going down, typically you will end up going to an emergency room. We have the ability to perform an endoscopy and possibly dilate a stricture or treat erosive esophagitis that might preclude you from having to present to an emergency room. Another considered emergency would be if you're having persistent rectal bleeding or blood in your stool. Many of our patients, especially the elderly, are on anticoagulants, things such as aspirin and Plavix, Eliquis, and the like. And gastrointestinal bleeding is quite common. And sometimes the bleeding is not severe, but it can be indolent, and over time, these patients can become weak, anemic, or dehydrated. So these types of procedures, anemia, bleeding, difficulty swallowing, we are able to deem them emergent or urgent and able to treat these patients during the COVID shutdown.
It's really good to know that, because, look, I know that myself and others are really fearful of going to the hospital. Because we know that, you know, infections and diseases travel, and let's put it this way, it's a hotbed to get those things. So it's nice that you can call your doctor and say you've got this issue, and you can treat that without showing up in the ER, which I think is a nice thing to know that people can get these kind of treatments. So, Dan, COVID-19... They, because of the governor's proclamation, certainly has had ramifications on your day-to-day business. I know that Arizona, the numbers, I think you shared them with me. They're changing every single day. But how many cases do we have that have been tested and recorded positive, and how many deaths do we have so far in our state?
Currently, as of today, Arizona is ranked 23rd on the list of states for the number of cases. There's 1,769 official cases of COVID. We did report 171 new cases in the last 24 hours. This is mostly due to marked increase in testing and test results coming through. We have a total of 41 deaths. That's 9 new deaths reported in the last day or two. So our numbers are increasing. It is worrisome. It is scary for most people. And it is going to get worse before it gets better, but the end will be in sight. One thing that is encouraging to me is that Arizona is not moving up on the list of states, meaning we're holding our rank at approximately 23rd and not increasing. And that's because people are heeding the social distance and hand washing and stay-at-home precautions.
So I do want to just share before we take our break here, you mentioned Honor Health, but they have an accountable care organization called Innovation Care Partners.
I believe your company is also a member of Innovation Care Partners.
We're
correct?
One of the preferred providers, and you know, I work directly with Dr. Karen Vanasky and Dr. Savas Petrides, an incredible organization, and I know you're working with them too. And my hat's off to them. They're really jumping on this COVID-19, trying to collect PPE and trying to make sure we all have the resources that we need. We're down halftime here at Health Futures. I got Dr. Dan Meline here in the studio. Stick around. We got more to talk about COVID-19 as well as colorectal cancer awareness. We'll be right back.
Now back to Health Futures, taking stock in you. If you have questions about your own or your loved one's future health care, call 602-264-8009. Now, here's your host, Cypress Home Care Solutions, Bob Roth.
Good afternoon. You're listening to Health Futures, taking stock in you. I'm your host, Bob Roth, and if you're just tuning in, I've got Dr. Dan Meline here in the studio. He's a gastroenterologist. Did I do good?
Yep. Third time's a charm.
Third time's a charm. He's practicing here in Scottsdale, Arizona for 28 years. He's also the medical director of Scottsdale Endoscopy Center, and he's the founding member of the Arizona Digestive Health, with offices valley-wide. And he's also celebrating a birthday in a few days. So happy birthday, Dr. Dan. And if you missed our first half, we talked about a lot of different things. The first segment we dedicated to Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month. In the second segment, we talked about COVID-19 and its implications as it relates to colon cancer, but the fact that we have discovered now that this virus is showing up in feces and in the digestive tract. So he did share some information with regards to that. And the one thing I will just emphasize, we're talking about hand washing, and certainly if you are going to use the restroom and do a number two, you should be washing your hands. And if you do have this virus on you or many other things that he talked about, C. diff and others, you will get that virus off your hands. So wash your hands, 20 minutes. That's what they're saying.
20 seconds.
20 seconds. So just, really picking up on the way we left off in the first half, we talked about Innovation Care Partners, and they are an accountable care organization here in town, and both of us are preferred providers to this network, and they are really taking the proverbial bull by the horns in terms of the COVID-19 epidemic that is happening right now. And you know, Dan, you've had some very detailed conversations. Obviously, you are a clinician that works with them. Can you give us a little more insight as to how you're working with Innovation Care Partners, otherwise known as ICP?
Well, it started with daily updates and meetings and phone calls and text messaging, but they are taking inventory now from all of us. How many gloves do we have? How many face shields do we have? How much personal protective gear do we have? How many N95 masks do we have? What are our anticipated needs? What can we give up? So they're taking inventory of what is available should this epidemic start to increase here in Arizona. Not only is the Army Corps of Engineers taking measurements of the parking lot at Honor Health, should tents need to be tents need to be erected. I know they are repurposing the old St. Luke's Hospital, which I worked at over 25 years ago. But our ambulatory surgery centers, like Scottsdale Endoscopy Center and others, are very well suited to help take the burden off of the hospital system. We have oxygen tanks and suction and private beds and IV poles and IV fluid, and we would be able to house and care for sick patients that need to be hospitalized who are not COVID positive to take the overflow from the hospital so that they can focus and concentrate on the more acute patients. So I do commend ICP and others for being proactive. Honor Health sent out a memo to all of their physicians, even the retired ones, asking if they would be willing to come back and reactivate to assist should things get out of control. Right now it's completely under control, but they're being very proactive and anticipating. Even the Arizona Medical Board has waived my relicensing application on my birthday next week and given me a grace period so I can continue to practice medicine for the foreseeable future.
Well, it's amazing. A lot of the relaxing of the standards that have happened. And, you know, one of the things that you and I talked about before we got the show started is that, look, you can operate on people who are experiencing these challenges and certainly avert going into the ER. But one of the things that is really, really taken off as a way to get a chance for a clinician like you to see patients is telehealth. And yeah, I want you to talk a little bit about that because I know that CMS is the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services has relaxed a lot of the rules. And I also know that clinicians like yourself, you know, usually when they do telehealth, the reimbursement is sometimes substantially less than you would receive in person. And I know that CMS has made some changes recently, and I'd love for you to share that. And certainly this is a vehicle for you to visit with patients where, you know, they can't get into the offices to see you.
That's correct. And telehealth medicine is new to me as well. I've practiced for almost 30 years, and we converted to telehealth last week, partly because of a relaxation in the regulations. But this disease has impacted our patients greatly. They're not at work. They're not at their jobs. Their 401ks have become 201ks.
I say 401 no-K.
401 no-K. They're under a lot of stress. They may not be sleeping. They may be fighting with their significant others. They're worried about money. And most people who are home all day tend to not have the greatest eating habits. And as you may know, Bob, we've talked about the brain-gut function before and the mind-gut connection. There's more serotonin in our enteric nervous system, meaning the gut, than there is in our central nervous system. So patients who are prone to anxiety or depression or not dealing with stress well tend to manifest it in their gut as well. So we're actually seeing an uptake of patients calling us with non-cardiac chest pain, severe heartburn and reflux, dyspepsia, they think they have a peptic ulcer, diarrhea, abdominal pain, gas, and bloating. So these patients don't want to be told that, I'm sorry, our offices are closed indefinitely. We are maintaining access, so we were able to convert to telehealth. We are trying to convert all of our patient appointments to telehealth. It's actually quite simple, as people are pretty used to doing FaceTime and Skyping. This is done on a third-party app to protect patients' private information and HIPAA violations. But when a patient does consent to telehealth, we're actually able to have a normal consultation and visit with the patient. Most of my patients now are giving them up to 30 minutes per visit. And the only part of the visit, the traditional physician visit, missing is the physical exam. So CMS and the third-party carriers have allowed us to perform a consultation or office visit minus the vital signs and physical exam as if it were an in-office visit. And all copays are being waived right now. So any patients who are willing can either Skype in, go on their computer, their smartphone, their tablet. And if they're unable to do that, as some of our elderly patients have not been able to master the technology, we can simply do a telephone consultation with the patients. It's helping them maintain connection. It's helping to address some of their fears and anxiety as well. And it's also helping to keep patients away from urgent care centers, emergency rooms, and hospitals, which are straining for resources right now.
And certainly I see, you know, telehealth, you know, and pardon me for using this cliche, but it's kind of somewhat of a game changer. And I really think that when we get through all of this, I think the way medicine is going to be practiced is going to be twofold. One, obviously, to see you in the studio, in your practice, or to maybe visit by telehealth. And I think a lot, because you see a lot of elderly patients, and it's hard for them sometimes to be able to get in to see you, but they could do a quick visit with you via telehealth. I see that in the future. Do you not see that as well?
I absolutely agree, Bob. I think that's one of the many things that are going to change after we get through this virus epidemic, and we will get through this virus epidemic. I think that handshaking will be something of our parents' generation and will go by the wayside after what we've all experienced. I think very few people are going to be shaking hands in the future.
Or giving hugs. I'm not giving you a hug right now, and I know you're going to be 60.
No bro hug right now.
No bro hug for sure. But I will say this. One of the biggest challenges I see, and we can pick up on it in our fourth segment, is the fact that older adults are being socialized or socially isolated. And the numbers that we had before was one-third of our population, 65 and older, was alone in their home. And that number in the next decade is going to be closer to 50%. And that word social isolation, I've known and I've been talking about it here on the show. And now the world knows about it. We need to figure out how to fix this for older adults. And I want to focus in on social, not so much isolated, so that we can be more social with our older adults. Got a little Marshall Tucker taking us out for the third segment. That, you know, being almost 60, you probably remember that band.
Yes, I did.
I do as well. Well, listen, you've been listening to Health Futures Taking Stock in You. I'm your host, Bob Roth. We're up against a break. We've got Dr. Dan Meline in here. We're talking colorectal cancer awareness as well as COVID-19. Stick around for our final segment. We'll be right back.
Now back to Health Futures, taking stock in you. If you have questions about your own or your loved one's future health care, call 602-264-8009. Now, here's your host, Cypress Home Care Solutions, Bob Roth.
Welcome back. You're listening to Health Futures, taking stock in you. And if you're just tuning in, I got Dr. Dan Meline here in the studio. We're on segment number four. You can reach us or at least listen to this entire show and about 300 others on our website at cypresshomecare.com. Click on the media button. Third button down is radio show. So since we have this last segment, I want to just jump right back in with Dr. Dan. First of all, if you want to talk to him or visit him, I'm going to give him a plug here. Go to drmeline.com. That's drmeline.com or call his office at 480-860-1990. So this segment has been dedicated to talking about colorectal cancer awareness. It's also been talking about COVID-19. And, you know, one of the things that Dan and I were talking about at the break is cancer does not wait for COVID-19.
COVID does not care about cancer, and cancer does not care about COVID.
Right.
And we take the COVID very seriously. It's horrible and serious. It's going to get worse before it gets better. But to put it in perspective, Bob, to date, 41 people in Arizona have died of the virus. And unfortunately, there will be more deaths. And everyone is concerned. But almost 19,000 Arizonans are going to get colon cancer.
19,000.
19,000.
And is that an annual number every year? About 19,000?
Approximately 19,000.
Wow. That's crazy.
And to put it in perspective also, this year in 2020, nearly 50,000 Americans will die of colorectal cancer. 50,000 deaths from colon cancer, the most preventable cancer that we have. And unfortunately, we got pushed back by the virus. So March is Colon Cancer Awareness Month. Usually people are made aware. They get on the ball. But right now, everyone's putting this off because of other fears and concerns. But
and your message, don't put it off.
Well, we're still taking a lot of telehealth visits to schedule people's procedures in June, July, and August. So there's once this virus lifts and the shortage of supplies lifts, there's going to be a huge backup. Forgive my pun.
Right. And that's okay. You're always good for those.
Be a bit of a rush, and we want to be prepared and have people on the books. And we gastroenterologists believe that we will be able to make it up with a tailwind.
There you go. I like that too. Bum bum. But truthfully, I love your message. Cancer is not going to wait for COVID. Cancer is happening every day. You talked about this, I believe it was at the end of the first segment, about your new mom that had a big polyp, and she was listening to her body. So my message to our audience, your message to the audience, is listen to your body. And if something's not right, you need to get in to see your doctor. And if you're getting, if you're having, you know, challenges with your digestive system, if you're having challenges with your esophageal system, Dr. Dan's the man to see.
Another message I'd like to leave with your audience, because this is an argument I hear from my patients a lot. Oh, I eat spinach and kale and quinoa, and I'm a healthy, clean eater, and my parents are in their 90s, and I don't drink, and I don't smoke, and I exercise, and I'm not overweight, and I have a nice, healthy bowel movement every day. Therefore, I won't get colon cancer. It's true that your risk is lower because you're healthier, but what I usually explain to my patients is that if you rotate the tires in your car and check the air pressure and change your oil and obey the speed limits and you're a safe driver, you won't get in a car accident, right? Mm-hmm. Same analogy. Even vegetarians get colon cancer. So those things are important: to eat a well-balanced diet, maintain a healthy weight, be active, know your family history, talk to your doctor about any changes in your health history, limit alcohol consumption to moderation. Smoking is a big factor for pancreatic cancer, bladder cancer, skin cancer, throat cancer, esophageal cancer, as well as lung cancer. People forget that. Coffee is not bad for you. Caffeine is not bad for you. It's gotten a bad rap, but there's a lot of health benefits to coffee if it's not overly roasted and burnt. And every time somebody has a stomach ache and they rush to an urgent care or an emergency room and they get an x-ray of their stomach, they are also getting some radiation, albeit low, but you want to limit your radiation exposure and not get over-tested with virtual colonographies and CT scans and barium enemas.
So we're in the COVID-19 era right now. So what is your message, Dan, to those that are staying at home and, you know, lifestyle stuff that you just talked about? Because, you know, we're eating, you know, many people are, you know, maybe abusing alcohol and other substances. You know, now's the time to be really vigilant, to really be, you know, trying to maintain your health and be healthy. What do you recommend for our listeners?
Well, just as you said, it's a stressful time and everything is different right now. So trying to maintain as much normalcy as you're able to in your daily routine, and then just get up off the couch, stop binging Netflix, just take a walk outside in your backyard. Try to eat healthy. My family this past weekend got on Zoom and we played games from Israel to San Francisco to Georgia, New Orleans and Washington, and my elderly parents, who are very upset that they had to cancel their trip to Spain and Morocco at age 87 and 83. But we enjoyed some family time that we may not have enjoyed in our daily activities. Bob, you alluded before about isolation and social isolation. Many of my elderly patients, visiting their doctor is their social life. They go to their ophthalmologist, they go to their audiologist, they go to their podiatrist, they see their cardiologist, they see their internist, they come see their gastroenterologist, they know the names of all the staff. It is their social life.
So true.
Being able to offer them a telephonic or telehealth video connection so that they can maintain those visits from the safety of their home, I think is a game changer, as you mentioned before.
Well, and certainly the fact that you talked about foods you eat and things to drink. I mean, we don't know how long we're going to be staying at home. So, practicing some of these really good habits, this is probably a really good time to do just this, right?
Absolutely. Hydration is important. We're starting to warm up in the warmer months. I also want to stress, I don't want people to be afraid of the virus in feces. You're supposed to be washing your hands anyway. So as long as you're doing what you're supposed to be doing for cough and droplet spread, you'll be okay from a GI point of view. One last message, I just want to remind our listeners that you may acquire COVID-19 and have absolutely no symptoms for 24 hours prior to the onset of symptoms, whether it be cough, fever, shortness of breath, or diarrhea. So be aware that you could be walking around spreading the virus for 24 hours before you even know you have it. And if you are sick, you could be harboring transmissibility for approximately 5 to 6 days after you feel better. So for those of you who have sheltered at home, who are feeling ill, and you're finally feeling better, it's not the time to rush out to Costco or Albertsons and hit the market because you're finally better. Give it another 5 days afterwards.
And for our younger people out there who may be, everyone knows the word asymptomatic now, which most doctors knew what that was before and most clinicians did. We may not be presenting any symptoms. This is the time to really heed this day at home. Dr. Dan Meline, thank you for being here in the studio. If you need to reach his office, 480-860-1990 or drmeline.com. Make it a great day. Have a great weekend. Be safe.
No place like home. You've been listening to Bob Roth's Health Futures. If you have questions about your own or your loved one's future health care, call Cypress Home Care Solutions at 602-264-8009. That's 602-264-8009. Or visit cypresshomecare.com. Be sure to join Health Futures with Bob Roth every Friday at noon, right here on Money Radio 1510 and 105.3.